Joining us today for his take on the market, Swaroop Gupta of the Economist Intelligence Unit. Swaroop, welcome back to Market Edge. Hi.
Hi, thank you for welcoming me back, and always a pleasure to be on your show.
All right, so we're starting a brand new month and a brand new quarter. Are you seeing more market declines from here? I mean, summer in the West is about to kick in, so that could mean traders staying on the sidelines, at least on the Western side.
Well, as far as, you know, U.S. markets are concerned, possibly as long as the Federal Reserve continues to proceed on its cycle of rate hikes, you could see these intermittent sell-offs happening. But the good news probably is that as far as Asian markets are concerned, though the sell-off hasn't completely ended, they are better positioned to stare down a U.S. recession, and they may even be able to lure investors away. So if you look at, market history, just as soon as you see signs of economic trouble in the U.S., there's major sell-offs in Asian markets, like we've seen this time around. But what happens is it leaves valuations in a good place when the actual contraction arrives. So the U.S. economy hasn't actually begun slowing down or contracting to the extent that economists and even the IU expects, if you will. So if you look at 2009, for example, when the U.S. exited the so-called Great Recession, by that time, emerging market stocks and bonds had already bottomed out, even a year ago. And this time, the sell-off began in the first quarter of 2021. That's a full year before developed market sell-offs, that you're seeing now. So, valuations are attractive. They are very well positioned in emerging markets to, withstand the shocks of slowdown in the United States and parts of the developed world. And, there could be good news for Asian investors pretty soon.
Mm-hmm. So why don't you break down your outlook for the second half of the year by telling us what your second half picks are, the top three asset classes that you think have the best chances to provide decent returns. Are you still looking at emerging market stocks? Are you starting to look at currencies with a dollar very strong, or other alternatives like maybe cryptocurrencies?
No, I think you've got my bugbear there in terms of cryptocurrency. That's been a really sort of really sad story. We've seen the fact that they are not linked at all. It's not an inflationary hedge at all. And sadly, it seems to be a long crypto winter is in place. But as far as, asset classes are concerned, I'm not saying that markets are out of trouble yet. So I'd still, at least, for the next month or two, advise caution. Yes, equities do look pretty sort of relatively cheap compared to other peers across the world. But at the same time, I would continue to sort of advise caution. So at this point, investors need to continue to be risk averse for a month or so, maybe a couple of months, and could look at actually picking up beaten down blue chip stocks. That's been the case for retail as well as institutional investors in Asian markets for the last month or so. Also, you need to, extend your horizon to slightly longer term, maybe, a year or 2 years, and also limit the size of your investments. The other thing to look at is specifically companies with lower levels of leverage, so that debt servicing ratios remain within, sort of limited means. And at the same time, companies are well positioned to withstand a larger economic crisis. At the same time, they can take advantage of opportunities, investors to buy distressed, these companies can take advantage of opportunities to buy distressed assets and raise their market share at this time. So they'll become even stronger when they emerge. Mm-hmm. So at this time, investors should be looking at blue chip stocks instead of small and mid caps, because that is the category of stocks that recovers first when we reach, the beginning of a new expansionary cycle.
Mm-hmm. I want to go back to the central bank conversation. Swaroop, there's a saying, don't fight the Fed. The central bank is your friend. Is it? Is that how markets feel today generally and globally? Or are markets starting to lose trust and faith in these central bankers who are now, by the way, under immense pressure to tighten, even at the expense of choking growth? Where is the credibility at this moment?
So, this moving target, this difficult choice that central bankers face between growth imperatives and controlling inflation, that's not something to deal with. At the same time, there seems to be you know, people agree in unison that the Fed may have got it a little wrong and may have started tightening a little late, and everyone else is following suit. At the same time, you know, we actually believe that more than the Fed, you know, if you look at stronger macroeconomic factors, even the war in Ukraine hasn't really impacted Asian markets to that extent. What has impacted it is a slightly weaker outlook for China. That's what's impacting Asian markets. That's what being factored in. However, we can't rule out the impact of the war in Ukraine completely. Higher commodity prices will feed into consumer prices across the region, but it'll be uneven, depending on, you know, various factors such as the extent of imports. But we do see, we think that, you know, inflation readouts, particularly in specific countries like Thailand and, happily enough, the Philippines, will start to weaken.
When you look at, you know, the interlocking events, the web of geopolitical stories that are forming the narrative of today, it begs the question, is it time to rethink globalization? I mean, look at how COVID lockdowns in China disrupted supply chains because key parts were put on hold, or how Russia's invasion of Ukraine caused prices of fuel halfway across the globe to skyrocket. Swaroop, is the two-decade era of globalization, you think, coming to an end? Are investors and businesses, you know, doing a lot of big rethinking? What is the trend moving forward? Is it time to bring the operations back home?
Well, I can't completely deny what you're saying. There will be some amount of reshoring of supply chains and, you know, interlinking. But at the same time, some global supply chains are so complex that it doesn't really make sense to completely unwind them. Pharma or automotive, for that instance, you know, it's just more cost effective. So it'll probably come closer home, but it won't come home. So, you know, there'll be more U.S. auto parts being made in Mexico, but won't be made in the United States, for example, which is what happened in the first place. At the same time, I would say that, you know, I would just reiterate and say the major issue here has been, you know, China's decision to live with lower growth and instead move ahead and keep sort of sustaining the zero COVID policy. That has led to more supply chain disruptions because China is, you know, definitely supplies parts and intermediates to most of the world. That's the reason why this is happening. And that's likely to, you know, not get people to move completely away from China, manufacturers and companies, but they will hedge their bets. They'll look at other areas to reshore their supply chains, move their parts manufacturing and intermediates manufacturing. And it could benefit several countries across the region.
I want to end this conversation, Swaroop, with another big issue. Let's talk about reverse currency war that's happening. That's if you agree that it is actually happening. You know, economies, instead of depreciating their currencies to take advantage of international trade, are doing the opposite, deliberately defending and boosting the currencies. Because rather than boosting growth, the goal is now to tame inflation, since a stronger currency would mean imports become cheaper. Do you think that works? And who do you think are the early winners and losers of such a war, so to speak?
Well, actually, there are no winners and losers of such a war, to speak, at the end of the day. But that's not our central forecast of this currency, reverse currency war happening. We do forecast a stronger dollar at the EIU in 2022. There'll be successive rate hikes. But if you look at policy normalization, will remain slower across the world than in the U.S., especially in the Eurozone, to avoid a sharp increase in long-term interest rates. So we don't expect the euro, for example, to reach parity with the dollar. At the same time, you know, the Japanese central bank has insisted on keeping the yen weaker. So we believe that the yen will actually depreciate further against the dollar. The only major currency that is probably looking to appreciate that too in 2023-26 is the British pound. However, this is one of our central global risk scenarios. So while it's not a central forecast, what you're saying could definitely happen. In the event that it does happen and monetary policy tightening in Asia continues to lag behind, so, you know, developed markets raise rates in unison, but, you know, developing economies, especially in Asia, continue to lag. So that raises financial market and currency risks. And unfortunately, in that situation, the Philippines and Thailand are among those really vulnerable countries they've got low policy rates and slightly weak current account positions at this point.
All right. On that note, Swaroop, always a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you for the insights and for the time.
Thanks, Michelle.